Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Orphan Warriors, Children of the Otori, Book 1, written by Lian Hearn and read by Patrick Harvey. Dedication for Kay. Even without parents, a child grows up. Japanese proverb. Prologue. Towards the end of the year that saw the death of Otori Takeo after his estrangement from his wife Kaede, a peace agreement between the Otori clan and Saga Hideki, the emperor's general, was sealed by the betrothal of Takeo's daughter and heir, Shigeko, to Lord Saga. The tragedies, murders, and betrayals of that terrible time when families in the clans and in the tribe turned on each other left many in the three countries grieving and embittered, especially when Saga showed he had no intention of keeping his word. Kaede and her youngest daughter, Miki, sought healing and forgiveness, while Mayoshi Kahe planned to confront Lord Saga and Sugita Hiroshi craved revenge. Not only the living but the dead, including Taku and Sada, unjustly killed before their time, demanded redress. Among the bereft was Arai Sunaomi, whose father, Zenko, had chosen the warrior's path and paid for his ambition with his life. Sunaomi was spared on condition he and his brother never leave the temple at Terayama, where Takeo's oldest friends, the abbot Makoto and Mayoshi Gemba, taught the way of the Hō, and where Takeo's son, Hisao, also lived. It was as if there were pieces on a board which had been kicked over, each scattered in the dirt and alone. Chapter 1. He had been a warlord's firstborn son, but now he was an orphan. At the winter solstice, he lay awake in the freezing room he shared with the other boys and the older monks, and realized it was weeks since anyone had called him by his name. They beckoned to him with open fingers, or addressed him as, "Hey, you." It was clear his former life was over, but he had no idea what would replace it. His life had been spared on condition he never leave the temple, but he could not really believe that the rest of his days would be spent here in the strict pattern of short nights and long days, fasting, meditation, study, and self-denial. He tried not to think about the things he missed so much. The big things were too overwhelming to dwell on. But on nights like these, when he could not sleep, he found himself yearning for the salty, oily taste of grilled fish, the sweetness of a persimmon, the feel of new silk robes on the first day of the year, the warm smell of his pony, the way she swung her head towards him and wicked at him. It was completely dark. Around him, he could hear the calm breathing of his companions, broken by coughing from his younger brother, once called Chikara, now as nameless as he was. He wanted to call out to him, to creep over to his mat and lie beside him, but they were forbidden to speak to each other, kept apart day and night. The windows were all shuttered, but the cold air penetrated the room. He could not get warm. If he exhaled, he could see his own breath floating above him. He felt he was the only person awake. Now and then, one or other of the boys spoke in sleep. He wondered what they saw in their dreams. Just before midnight, it seemed to grow very slightly warmer. A feathery sound came from outside, soothing him. He was on the verge of sleep when the bell sounded to rouse the monks for prayer. Half awake, he followed the boys along the corridor to the courtyard. One of them jostled him and whispered, "Arai, traitor." It was not the first time. The boys often fell silent at his approach, as if they had been talking about him, sharing rumors that he wanted to hear but dreaded. They were not supposed to talk at all. Apart from the chanting and their teacher's dictation, silence enveloped Terayama, a silence that made the sounds of nature seem all the more intense. The wind in the ancient cedars, the harsh cawing of crows, the mournful owls, the sudden squeaking of mice beneath the floorboards. It was snowing in large, steadily falling flakes that had already coated the ground, the lanterns, the branches of trees. Shafts of lamplight shone in the blackness, reflecting off the white curtain. Someone in the depths of the temple was playing a flute. A gong echoed from the main hall. Sudden beauty made him catch his breath. There were moments when he felt the pull of a life dedicated to prayer. A kick on the ankle was followed by another insult. Rage burned in him, and he spun around. But the eyes of his teacher, Gemba, were on him, and beneath that steady gaze, both he and his tormentor subsided. He liked Gemba, and felt close to him, for he knew Gemba had a deep affinity with the bears of the forest, and the bear's paw was the symbol, had been the symbol, of his clan. Chikara was coughing again, struggling to catch his breath. He sounded really sick, but sickness rarely excused anyone from the routine of rising at midnight to chant and pray until sunrise. The discipline was meant to strengthen both body and spirit. "Your little bear cub isn't going to see the new year," Hisao whispered next to him, speaking out of the corner of his mouth, a strategy he had perfected. Hisao had nicknames for everyone. The boy's aunt, who had brought him and his brother to the temple, Hisao called the Widow, and her daughter, Miki, Revenge. The boy wished he saw more of them. They were his family, after all. But they kept to the guest residence where they continued mourning the dead. He wondered if Hisao had a name for him. Hisao ignored Gemba's reproving gaze, as he always did. He was disobedient beyond correction, often acting out of spite, deflecting any attempts to reach him, refusing appeals to his better nature. Gemba treated him with a gentle forbearance, found blocks of wood, cherry, peach, and cypress, and gave him knives to carve them. Hisao drew animals out of the wood with effortless talent. The boy admired this. He also felt a complicated and painful pity, and he did not respond to Hisao's teasing, unlike the other boys who were afraid of his cruel tongue and unsettled by his open defiance of the older monks. An uneasy feeling had grown between them, not really friendship, but not enmity either. Hisao's words troubled him, for he felt they were true. At the first meal of the day, he could see Chikara's flushed cheeks and watery eyes. He coughed incessantly and hardly ate. Afterwards, the older brother was given the task of sweeping away the flurries of snow that lay on the verandas, melting in the morning sun. The sky had cleared. In the surrounding forest, the trees were heavy with the white blossom of winter. Snowy peaks soared in the distance, pink and gold in the morning light. One of the monks, a tall, lean man, was brushing snow off logs and piling them in a basket. It was hard to tell the monks apart. There were so many of them. And with their shaved heads and somber-coloured robes, they all looked alike. The other boys were occupied with morning chores or study, but Hisao sat in the sunlight. He was carving. The boy watched, rapt, his broom forgotten as the bear cub emerged from the wood. "It's a miracle how you do that." His whisper sounded like a shout. A pheasant called in its shrill, insistent way from the forest. He could hear the clatter of wooden bowls and the sigh of steel knives, the pounding of rice. It was the season to make rice cakes for offerings for the new year. The great cold was slowly giving way to the opening of spring. There were buds on the butterbur flowers at the foot of the steps. He could taste the rice cakes on his tongue, but the idea that Chikara might not live to taste them filled him with apprehension.
"I've always been able to make things," Hisao replied. "I like tools. A good knife like this has a life of its own. All weapons do. They have their purpose. No matter what hand holds them, if you understand that, you have power over them, and they have to submit to your will. The knife knows what it wants from the wood. They talk to each other, and this is the result." He held out the half-finished cub. If I finish it, and if he's not dead, I'll give it to your brother.
You never finish things.
You're right. I don't.
Hisao smiled to himself. The boy studied him. He was almost a grown man, 7 or 8 years older, with smooth, dark-toned skin and thick black hair like a raven's wing. His mouth was rather wide and his brow low, above shrewd, wary eyes.
What are you staring at?
Hisao's voice was challenging. The boy began sweeping again.
Well, what? Just wondering. About you. Who you really are. Why you're here when you hate it all so much. If you have to stay here like I do.
We're not supposed to talk about ourselves,
Hisao began, mocking Mayoshi Gemba.
You're right, I'm sorry.
The broom was wet from the melting snow and left marks like claws.
So I'll tell you.
Hisao gave a short, scornful laugh.
I'm the son of Otori Takeo.
My uncle? The one who died?
Yes, he died. My mother's dead too. She was from the tribe. Do you know what that means?
Yes, he said, his heartbeat quickening. All his life he'd heard snatches of conversation, whispers on that subject, and because he wanted to impress Hisao, he said, My other uncle, before he died, he was in the tribe.
Hisao laughed again. You say it like it was a choice. You're not in the tribe. You're of it. Born into it, never allowed to escape.
Then he paused and said in a different voice,
I had forgotten. Taku was your uncle.
You knew him?
I killed him, you idiot.
Didn't you know that? Hisao stared directly at him, his eyes bright with malevolence.
On your father's orders, of course. Your father betrayed many people. Taku was only the first.
When the boy said nothing, Hisao went on.
That's what brothers are really like.
He looked at the carving resting in his palm, almost finished, exquisite, and made a crude gash with the knife, severing the bear cub's head.
Chikara won't get it after all. What a shame.
He threw the two pieces out into the garden, where they fell into the snow, leaving small dark holes. The boy stood, unmoving, the broom still in his hands.
But your uncle is tricky. He's tribe through and through, even in death. He won't leave me alone.
Hisao's eyes still glittered, but his voice had changed again, and the boy heard in it something close to terror. The air behind him seemed suddenly unnaturally dense. The snow-covered bushes in the garden became hazy and obscured. It was bright sunlight, and yet it was dark.
There is someone there, the boy thought.
But perhaps it was just a crow's shadow on the snow. He heard the sudden flap of wings, then behind him, Gemba's voice.
What are you doing out here chattering? Inside, in silence.
Hisao did not move. The boy, blushing as he always did when reprimanded, went to hang the broom in its place under the eaves. He was shaking, near tears. He stood for a few moments trying to control himself. The monk from the garden passed by, carrying the basket of logs, and seemed as if he would speak, but then Gemba appeared saying,
Our abbot wishes to see you.
Because I was talking to Hisao?
He himself will explain his reasons.
He followed Gemba down the long passageway, worrying about what the abbot wanted, and hoping he was not going to miss the midday meal. He had not been to this part of the temple, and had not realized how many smaller rooms lay behind the main halls, divided from the passage by screens. There were also many alcoves and niches, which held statues and scrolls. Oil lamps burned before them, throwing a warm glow on the dark, polished wood floor. At the end of the passageway, they crossed the courtyard behind the main gate and the guardhouse and turned into the cloister that ran down to the hall where the Seshu paintings were kept. His spirits lifted a little. At least he would get a glimpse of the paintings which he had seen once and had never forgotten. The abbot sat on the floor of this hall, overlooking the garden where the rocks that symbolized the mountains of the three countries were capped with snow, dazzling in the sunlight. He had once been a feared warrior, but he had laid aside his weapons to follow the way of the Hu'u. His name had been Makoto, and even though, as an abbot, he now had another name, this was how the boy always thought of him. Makoto wore a robe of dull-colored hemp that did not quite conceal his broad shoulders and strong arms. A small tabby cat lay curled in the folds.
"I have brought Arai Sunaomi to you,"
Gemba said, and he indicated that the boy should kneel. After a few moments, Makoto told him to sit up. He stared at the boy's face and said,
"Arai Sunaomi, this must be the last time anyone will call you by that name."
He turned to Gemba and said,
"He resembles his mother and the Shirakawa more than the Arai."
"That is a protection in some ways, but a danger in others,"
Gemba said enigmatically.
"I agree. You can leave us now. I want to talk to him alone."
When Gemba had gone, Makoto addressed the boy again.
"Well, you must forget your parents and everything from your former."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.